the nature of reality in 5 minutes. I'm not used to this challenge, except when I lived in India. When I went on train journeys in India, I often went on long train journeys, and on the journeys, as I sat there in this compartment, someone would open a conversation and they'd say, "What is your name? What is your native place? You know, are you married? How many brothers and sisters? How much do you earn?" They always ask that. And then when he got through all those basic things, they say, "What is your view of the nature of reality?" And I had long journeys on Indian trains discussing the nature of reality. This is, I think, the first time since Indian railways that I've been asked this question. So my own views of reality are shaped both by science and by Indian philosophy and by the Christian tradition. And so I can't claim to be speaking for a position that's a standard position, that that would be the standard scientific or standard Christian or standard Indian position. Starting with the scientific view, what the modern science has done is shown that the visible kind of reality we experience through our senses is in fact pervaded by many invisible connections. In fact, Isaac Newton in the 17th century, when modern science really began through the scientific revolution of the 17th century, came up with a vision of universal interconnectedness in his theory of gravitation, that every particle of matter in the universe attracts every other particle of matter. The whole of nature is interrelated by invisible interconnections. And we now call those the gravitational field, which links together everything in the universe. In the 19th century, Michael Faraday first discovered or named the electrical and magnetic fields. And we now think of the whole universe as filled with the electromagnetic field through which light travels, and not just visible light, but invisible light in the form of X-rays, cosmic rays, and so forth. Ultraviolet, so lots of invisible forms of light. And then through quantum theory, we have the idea that there are matter fields underlying the very nature of matter, and the matter we experience as hard and impenetrable is actually made up of vibratory patterns of activity within fields. So modern science, even conventional modern science, doesn't give us a view of reality being what it seems to be to the senses. There's a great deal of interconnectedness. In many ways, one could say that modern science is in the business of explaining the visible in terms of the invisible. And the other great vision of modern science is that the universe is evolutionary, not just life on Earth, not just human culture, but the entire universe, starting with the Big Bang, has been expanding, cooling down, and evolving so that more and more form, structure, order, pattern come into being in a creative universe. So if one then says, well, in this scientific worldview, what are the most fundamental realities? In the 19th century, people would have answered matter as the most fundamental reality, and that was the basis of the philosophy of materialism, which says matter is the only reality and mind is derived from matter in the brain. But in modern science, the answer to that question is fields and energy. Fields are what shape and structure everything. The sun is round because of the gravitational field. The fields are what shape the natural order, and energy is what gives it actuality, movement, change. Energy is what underlies the development of nature. It underlies matter itself. As David Bohm said, in the light of modern physics, matter is regarded as frozen light, that it's light energy bound in fields, vibrating to give us matter as we know it. Now, the big thing that's left out of this scientific picture is, of course, consciousness. And For materialists, that is the hard problem. It's called the hard problem because if you say that reality consists of unconscious matter and that's all there is, then how do you explain the fact that humans are conscious? Well, you can't, and that's why it's called the hard problem. So within science recently, there's been a move within philosophy of mind and indeed in neuroscience towards a more panpsychist view of nature, saying that maybe there's some kind of consciousness even in electrons and atoms, and that consciousness in human brains emerges from less complex organized systems, but consciousness pervades all matter, all the universe. Now, that is an increasingly popular view, and but it still sees consciousness as sort of emerging from complexities of matter. And it doesn't explain how the universe came into being in the first place, nor does it explain the creativity within the universe, nor does it explain the source of forms and matter and energy. Now, I myself, as a Christian, see the ultimate reality as the Holy Trinity. The ultimate reality, or God in the Christian version, is not an undifferentiated blob, certainly not an old man sitting on a cloud, but rather an organic combination of a ground of consciousness. God the Father is rather right like the Hindu view of Sat, Chit, Ananda, being, consciousness, bliss. God the Father is like Sat in the Hindu model, the ground of conscious being. And when God first announces himself to Moses in the Old Testament, and Moses says, "What is your name?" He says, "I am who I am," or "I am that I am." It's a statement that God's nature is of conscious being in the present, I am. Then the second aspect of God is the Logos in the Christian Trinity, which Hindus would call names and forms, Nama Rupa. It's all the forms of things in nature, that which can be known. God the Father is the knower. The Logos, or the Son aspect of the divine, is the known. And to have, you have consciousness which has this division within it of the knower and the known. And both of these are aspects of the divine. Both of them are aspects of God. It's not as if God the Father, the knower, is God and everything else isn't God. No, God the known, the names and forms in nature, are a reflection of this inherent principle of names and forms, or logos, within the divine. But that by itself would be static. And the Holy Spirit, which is the dynamical principle in the Holy Trinity, breath, wind, or energy, is the moving principle which gives actuality and activity to things. So everything in nature, both according to Christian theology and according to modern science, is made up of matter, is made up of energy and form, or energy and fields. Our bodies are shaped by the fields that shape living organisms. They're powered by the energy that flows through them and the breath with which we speak. So everything in nature has energy and form. An atom has energy, which gives it its actuality, and form, which gives it the quantum particles, the neutrons, the protons, the electronic orbitals around it. It's a structure of activity. The form is the structure, the activity is the energy. So I myself see all these aspects of nature as reflections of the Holy Trinity, the ultimate principle which underlies all nature and the evolution of the cosmos. So there you have it. That's perhaps somewhat longer than 5 minutes, but it's as short a summary as I can give.